Greetings. I'm Yvonne, staff for science for the public, and I welcome you to Contemporary Science Issues and Innovations. COVID-19 has profoundly affected global health and economic stability. But for decades, scientists such as our distinguished guest today have warned that human disruption of animal habitats will make such pandemics inevitable. Dr. Jonathan Runstadler is professor of virology, immunogenetics, and disease ecology at the Cummings School of Veterinary Science at Tufts University. He is a prominent veterinary and virus researcher, and he offers a unique approach to spillover pandemics, such as the influenza outbreak of 19 and today's COVID-19. That includes the viruses and their hosts, manner of virus transmission, and very crucially, the ecological disruptions that trigger so many of these spillover events. We're very honored to welcome Dr. Jonathan Runstadler. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here.
Good. And by Zoom already, too.
That's right. Anyway, we can.
And we are so pleased to get your expertise, and it's on multiple things, because today people are so highly specialized and don't combine all the different aspects of a thing, and you're right on it. So we really appreciate the opportunity to exploit your expertise. I'd like to start with the hosts themselves, because you have pointed out to that like 60% or better of viruses come from animals and birds, but some of them are quite distinct. Could you give us a little background on the hosts themselves, these reservoir creatures?
Sure, yeah, Yvonne, it's true that the majority of infectious diseases, emerging infectious diseases, come from animal species of one sort or another. And it is a variety and a wide variety of animal species from which viruses in particular emerge, but other pathogens as well. So there's several hosts that, you know, come to mind as particularly important ones. I'm sure many of your listeners probably have followed news about bats being important reservoirs for emerging infections, and some of them particularly nasty ones. But for a long time, we've known about viruses that have emerged from rodent species.
Yes.
Yeah, and of course, my work has focused a lot on influenza viruses, which we believe all have originated out of avian species, out of birds. So depending on what pathogen you're talking about and what the context is, there's a variety of different hosts that may be either reservoir species or perhaps intermediate hosts, where viruses pass from a reservoir species through another host on their way to infecting or emerging in human beings. And yeah, go ahead.
Well, one of the issues is that for our side, the non-experts, is that many of those hosts, reservoir animals, like the bats in Asia, that particular group perhaps, host the virus, but they themselves are immune, evidently, unless something else happens, and I follow through on that. But yeah. Why is that? And the same apparently with the birds that carry the avian host carry influenza. What is that immunity?
Yeah, so it's a really good question, and one that, you know, I'll start out with saying we don't fully understand the answer to that question, particularly for some of the different hosts. So, you know, we know how much research is going on in trying to understand human immunity even and how we respond to viral infection. And So you can imagine that trying to do that in all of the different animal hosts that we study is a equal, if not bigger challenge, because less resources are currently devoted to it. But we do know that there are certainly similarities, but perhaps more importantly, some differences between the way that the immune systems of different animal hosts respond to viral infection. So some of those differences are likely and maybe almost certainly important to the ability of those hosts to tolerate or carry as a reservoir, you know, without responding to the infection in a detrimental way to the host, or without the infection killing the host, and allow them essentially to perpetuate that pathogen or that virus in the environment. So, you know, bats is a good example where there's been a lot of work put into that species as a host because of some of the viruses that have apparently emerged from it in you know, particularly in the last 20, 30 years. And, you know, again, I'll say it's an active area of research, and there are some different views about it, but certainly there's parts of a bat's physiology and their immune response that are different from, you know, the way that a human responds. And there's some research that indicates that there are physiological adaptations that the bat has that are a part of its natural history that may also have sort of indirect impacts on the way that that host responds to viral infection, and suggests that those are potentially some reasons why the bat tolerates perhaps viruses more than some other hosts. But there's also research that suggests the relationship between a host like a bat and its ability to perpetuate or to serve as a reservoir for zoonotic infection is strictly related to the number of viruses that that host seems to be infected with and circulate naturally. And that number may be more dependent on the ecology of that particular host. So how many different species are there in that group of animals? How do they interact? How closely are they related so that they may be able to pass viruses back and forth between each other? And the other animals that they interact with as a part of the ecology in their environment. So no doubt it's a complicated question, what you're asking.
Right.
But as much as we know, there are certainly differences that probably contribute, especially in specific cases. You know, if we start talking about a specific virus, influenza is the one that I'm most familiar with, right? Yeah. So we believe that influenza viruses have been circulating in migratory bird species for a long, long time. And the period of time is probably such that those viruses, for the most part, have adapted with their host to be able to replicate but not cause a lot of pathology in that host.
So use the host.
Essentially use the host to perpetuate. That's right. And that persistence of the virus, in turn, sort of opens up opportunities for it to spill over to other hosts.
Got it. Okay. I'd like to ask a little bit about the viruses. I know that you have really specialized on the influenza viruses, and they've been around forever and ever. And these coronaviruses probably have been also. But some of these things are really deadly. Some things are related, like the common cold, but they're not deadly as a general. Do you know anything about those, the nature of the viruses, that you could tell us why they're so good at being deadly?
Yeah. So again, another great question that we wish we knew more of the answers to. But I think from a high level sort of understanding, there's probably two big reasons why when we see an emerging virus, it sometimes is particularly deadly or pathogenic, right, and causes severe disease. And part of that has to do with the way that viruses themselves replicate and persist, right? So some viruses use the pathology that they cause in their host as a means of being transmitted to the next host, right? And so the common cold is a great example of that, where, you know, when somebody is infected and they're sneezing and they're coughing, they're more likely to transmit those viruses through their coughs to somebody else than if they weren't coughing. So that's an example of where the pathology of that virus, that it's making the person cough and making the respiratory system inflamed and ill, is helping that virus persist. The other probably major reason we see much more deadly viruses is when we essentially become accidental hosts, right? So oftentimes these deadly infections or severe infections are associated with what we're talking about, these emerging or spillover events, where it's a new virus in our population. And that virus essentially has an entire human population to infect that doesn't have any prior immunity. So it can spread extremely rapidly. And because it can spread extremely rapidly, it doesn't necessarily have to worry about causing severe, I mean, I'm anthropomorphizing a little bit here, but it doesn't suffer from causing severe disease in any given host, because it knows it's already going to be passed to 2, 3, 4 other people that are perpetuating it. Yes. And the fact that it's a spillover event goes back to what we were talking before, that our immune system isn't quite the same probably as the animal that it came from. So this is sort of a new virus in a new environment, and it may be doing the things it always does in the host that it came from, but it's interacting in different ways with our immune system that cause problems.
Yes, I see.
Over time, if that virus persists, you know, we think that's the way a lot of these viruses, like we were just talking about with flu and birds, that originally that may have been a more pathogenic infection in birds, but over long periods of time, the virus and the host co-adapted so that the virus.
Yes, right. So these things are, they're not supposed to be alive, but they are intelligent life, aren't they?
They're sometimes, right?
That's not true. You don't need a brain.
Right, you don't need much.
I'd like to go now to the actual transmission mechanisms. There are a couple of things there that, first of all, we've heard a lot about the wild meat markets, for example, that an ideal setting. But one of the questions for me has been that people have been eating wild meat for centuries and centuries, and you work on birds, people have been hunting ducks and so on. What is this transmission magic here? What's going on that something is transmitting the disease, and evidently not always.
Yeah, I think, you know, that's one where it really comes down to the changes in our world and the changes in the way that we interface with animals, right? So I think it's reasonable to assume from what we know that viruses have always been around, at least, you know, in terms of our context. And they've always been circulating in animal hosts too. You know, we know, particularly now with some of the techniques that we have for sequencing viral genomes and looking at the total complement of viruses in any given host, that there are lots and lots of viruses in the world. And in any given animal, there's many, many viruses that circulate. So those viruses have always been there. And where we're seeing spillover events has to do with the interface between two different hosts. So the wet markets or the meat markets that you mentioned, you know, are certainly seem to be one of these areas where you get animals from lots of different sources being brought both live and dead into a market situation where there's close contact between both the animals and the people. So that's an interface that seems to be well suited to the transmission of viruses. And viruses, you know, are transmitted generally, depending on the family of virus that they belong to, they're transmitted between secretions and respiratory routes and feces and those kind of things. So proximity and contact is a big part of that.
Okay.
But it's not, of course, you know, restricted to wet markets. There's lots of other different interfaces, you know, both in developing countries and in the Western world where we see these interfaces. And I think we're experiencing, you know, particularly in the world we live in now, increases in these interfaces, both because of human activity, but because of our population numbers and the way that we interact as a global community as well. So increased interactions, increased numbers of people interacting with animals in the environment, open up lots of different interfaces where we may see and some where we have seen spillover events.
Okay, I have just a couple more things to ask about that transmission before we leave the market, that process, which is very different from going out with your gun or your bow and arrow and capturing something, a deer or a bird or whatever. Right. Then that's a major issue, as you pointed out, sharing with a lot of people. But the other is the stress factor when, say, these animals are brought to a market, they're still alive, and then they're going to get killed. Does that stress aggravate any of this virus stuff?
Yeah, so again, a good question that there's active research going on to understand how physiology of an animal and things that impact that physiology, like stress, can might affect immune response and therefore the dynamics of infection in a given host. And I think based on what we know, there's good reason to hypothesize that in a stressful situation, an infected animal may undergo maybe more likely to transmit virus or shed virus into the environment. But those are all topics of ongoing research. I think what's clear is that the physiology of the host does impact the immune response, which is part of that physiology. So both mentally, physically, and depending on the particular host functionally, those are all aspects that could impact how that animal is shedding an infection, a virus, into the environment or interacting with another host. So again, it's a reason to think that in the wet market type situations, that may be a factor, or in other types of situations where you get animals into a situation that's not part of their natural behavior or history, you may impact the transmission and the dynamics of disease.
Okay. One more thing there, just on this transmission factor. A lot of people, there are intermediate hosts, I guess, what intermediates, which has come up with the Wuhan market and with other cases as well. But many people out there are concerned with how the transmission occurs, like, say, from infected individuals or animals, and then passing that on, like, it doesn't go to everything, and not all excretions, for example, cause transmission. Right. So can you tell us anything about that, why that is the case?
Well, so I think the first thing to realize is that, you know, viruses are similar as a group in many ways, but when we talk about an influenza virus versus a coronavirus versus a, you know, polio virus, they're very different in some ways too, right? So So a virus that causes infection in one host may be shed through a respiratory route. So like we're talking through coughing, respiratory secretions out of the lungs or the upper respiratory system, whereas another virus might infect the GI tract and be shed through feces more like. And other viruses even are spread through contact with blood or other bodily fluids. So the way that a virus spreads may be highly dependent on the life history or the natural history of that virus in the host.
Okay.
And then the other part of that is to understand that a virus has a course of infection in a given animal. So when it first infects a host, that virus is not being shed as an infected virus. And it may take several days, weeks in some contexts, for the virus to reach a point in that host where it's now shedding transmissible virus. So you can get an infected host that's maybe in a market situation, but it's not shedding infective virus, whereas another infected host is.
Okay.
So it depends a lot on the particular virus, the host that it's infecting, and where that virus is in its natural infection. So later in infections, a host might be shedding virus, but that virus might be non-infective because it's coated with the antibodies that the host has produced to fight its own infection, and therefore they're not infective to another host.
I see. And just sort of related that they're in, for example, with the coronavirus, but also with the flu viruses so on, not every creature gets infected. So people worry about whether pets will be infected by this, or that we had a case of, say, I think it was lions in a zoo that did get infected. So there, but not everything gets infected. So does that have to do with the systems of those respective creatures? Do you see what I mean? That it's naturally immune, in other words.
Yeah, sure. So it may in part, and it may in part have to do with the behaviors and that interface that we were talking about. So We actually are particularly interested in COVID-19, how this virus might be infecting animals like pets that are in close contact with people. And we have a study looking at that. I think we're fortunate in many ways that this virus, at least right now, only seems to very rarely infect pets or other animals that are in close contact with humans. But the fact that we do have some reports of infection, and you mentioned the lions and tigers at the Bronx Zoo, is probably the most interesting or sensationalistic one. But there's a few reports of cats and dogs globally being infected. And that shows that there's that possibility there, right? So why there isn't more of that going on is, again, a good question that we and others are doing research on, but it could be a couple of different things. So I mentioned, you know, it might just have to do with the behaviors, that the way that people and those animals interact isn't in a way that the people, or the animals in this case, are coming into contact with infective virus. You know, even if somebody cuddles with a cat, maybe they're not breathing directly into their face, and so it's not as much of an exposure as you might expect. But there might also be biological reasons. So it might be that the immune systems of those animals, so we mentioned there are differences, even subtle ones, but subtle ones can have an impact between the way that a cat responds immunologically and the way that a human responds immunologically. And it may be that for this given instance, for this given coronavirus, that cats respond in a slightly different way that allows them to either prevent or clear an infection more rapidly than the human host does. And there's some indication that that's true. So people have experimentally infected house cats, and they appear to get infected with the virus and to shed virus, but they don't appear to show clinical signs.
Okay.
So in some way, the subtle differences are having an effect, and those cats appear to tolerate infection better than their human hosts. It could be, though, too, that, you know, the other thing we're worried about here is the ability of infected animals to transmit back to a human host.
Right. Right.
And it doesn't appear to be much evidence of that. There's some suggestion that the mink farms in the Netherlands have been an instance of that, but otherwise there isn't much evidence. And that there's, you know, another possibility there, which is that even if a virus is able to infect a host, it may not be able to be transmitted on from that host. So those are, in some ways, two different processes in the life history of a virus.
Right.
So the fact that it can attach to a host cell and get into that host cell and start replicating could be different from its ability to actually be shed from the animal into the environment.
Really good point there. Thank you for that. Now I'd like to get into the really juicy stuff, because this is we've heard lots and lots about viruses recently, but we have not heard about the disease ecology part. Mm-hmm. So that is that's the good part. That's the part we really need to understand. You've been at this for a long time.
Right.
Now I get a chance to pick your brain on that. So how does that work when you talk about disease ecology, this kind of disruption? How does that work? And especially, how might that be different today from centuries and centuries where, say, people lived in the Amazon and everybody lived happily ever after?
Right.
What's the difference?
Well, I'm not sure they lived happily ever after, but there are a lot of good things about the way that we live, but we're going through a bad stretch.
Right.
So no, that's a really important point. I think you're right that it's part of the science that is easy to overlook, and particularly when we're focused on response to an emerging virus like we are with the COVID-19. But it's an extremely and again, yes, my view is biased by the work that we've done, but an extremely an important thing for us to consider if we're going to prevent or prepare for these kind of events in the future. And it really, in part, comes down to what we were talking about previously about the way that we interact with the animals and the environment that we're a part of. So my research group has spent many years now studying influenza viruses in animal hosts. And part of our goal with that research is to understand how those viruses persist in the animal hosts that they transmit in, and how they change over time in this world, this environment that we live in. And part of the interest there is to understand, if we understand better how those viruses are able to transmit and persist in the animal hosts, then we may be better able to understand how changes to that natural history of the animals themselves may disrupt that natural history of the virus. So that's really what we mean by disease ecology. It's the intersection of the natural history of the virus with the natural history of the host and its environment. So we live in a world now that is much more populous, much more impacted by human activity, and much more connected than it's ever been. And there's lots of good things about that, like we said, but there's some things that we need to consider that may be bad things. And I think one of those things that's implicated by the current pandemic and by other events is that this more connected, more populous world is having an impact on our environment and the natural history of animals that makes emerging disease more likely.
Does that mean like our the human activities such as mining and big agriculture and the push of cities into what were more wilderness type areas, is that what you mean by that kind of disruption of these habitats?
So it's certainly part of it. And I guess I'm lumping anything in there that impacts the way that we interact with animal hosts and the environment. So in some ways, that's simply that, humans are more populous, and so we're pushing into wilderness areas, and that's increasing interfaces with wild animals. Mm-hmm. But in some cases, that has to do with agricultural or industrial processes where we're either using those animals in different and increased ways, and that mm-hmm. increases the interface that we have with them. Or again, we're disrupting the environments that those animals live in, and therefore disrupting or changing the natural history of those species. And those changes are likely to change the way that we interface with those animals. A very simple one that we're trying to look at with influenza mm-hmm. is the way that human industry in avian environments creates opportunities for birds to get together in larger flocks around human activity. So fishing is a one example of that, where there's major fishing industry that attracts birds, and those birds may be more likely to pass influenza viruses amongst themselves. We don't know that for sure yet, but that's one aspect that we're studying. It's a very simple human impact. And like I said, there's lots of great things about what the human industry is doing. We're able to get fish and seafood that we might not otherwise, and we're able to feed our communities. But we do have to realize that everything that we do is having an impact on the animals and the environment that we interact with. And there may be some negative aspects about that. That's in part what we're trying to look at.
So even if a part of it is just the scale, I guess, of our activities.
Right.
People have mined for centuries, they have farmed for centuries, but this is different this time. And there are so many of us that we're crowding other creatures out of the picture there. That's very interesting that you bring up that and actually creates the what do I say, farm fishing type of thing, industrial fishing is creating larger flocks, probably diverse flocks, and then you have all kinds of problems as a result of just that. That's most interesting. So I hope that is a field that really takes off. I realize that there are like environmentalists and then certain areas of science like yourself, and you have to have the veterinary background as well as virus background, and not many people have it. And so it's a huge contribution. I'm sure that, you'll be able to communicate, I hope, in the future a lot. I want to ask about these the programs or whatever, this One Health and Evolutionary Medicine, these programs that you are involved in or head up. Could you please give us some background about this?
Sure. Well, the rationale, the concept of One Health has been around for some time now. Even was a concept when the Tufts Veterinary School, which is a fairly young veterinary school, but it was part of the founding of the veterinary school in the 1980s at Tufts, was the idea that veterinary medicine and human medicine were connected. And really, that's the same concept behind, you know, the idea of One Health, is that the health of humans and the health of animals and the health of our environment are all interconnected in many ways. And it's been convenient and maybe necessary in lots of what we do to isolate and focus on one particular aspect of that. So, you know, to focus on human health and try to improve it. But like we said, you know, we're living in a much more interconnected and populous world now. And it's clear, more clear now perhaps than ever, that human health, animal health, and environmental health are linked. And that's what's really the rationale behind the One Health concept, and in some ways behind the concepts of evolutionary medicine, which is really founded on the basis that there's evolutionary reasons and ecological reasons for the way that animals respond to disease and humans respond to disease, and that the interactions of those species with the environment are interconnected, both in an evolutionary and an ecological context. So you're right. I think, you know, veterinarians are sort of one of the groups that's important in understanding these interactions, to be both trained in medicine, and many veterinary scientists are also trained in other sub-disciplines, you know, whether it's genetics or immunology or pathology. And so veterinarians play a role in a lot of different aspects of both human and animal health, and increasingly in the health of our environment.
It seems as though we cannot go forward without an understanding like this. So I'm just hoping that maybe this kind of expertise will be generated more widely, and that maybe college students will be introduced to this the future as just about, you know, just part of their education, because it's so obvious when you think about it, but that's not our training. Certainly in academic terms, people are very specialized. So this is great that you bring all of this.
Well, we get many students at the veterinary school at Tufts who have interests in these areas, and we'd love to have more. So
I hope that we can help get the word out to like high school students as well. This is very important, and they will be receptive to that. But I appreciate on behalf of everybody that you are doing this kind of work. And I realize I'm sure it's an enormous challenge. You have to have all this expertise in a number of different things. I wanted to just ask the last thing here about, obviously this leads to a need for policies, and those policies need to be much more comprehensive, not just, you know, as in climate and environment, recycling your stuff. That's not enough. It has to be governmental. And in this case, it looks like it needs to be international, a real commitment. How do you do it?
Yeah, great question. Again, if I knew the answer to that, right, I might be on to bigger and better things, perhaps. But it is, you know, something that we think about more and more now. I mean, obviously, the diseases that impact us or the animals that we're close to don't respect national borders or international borders, and don't understand the intricacies of human interactions.
Exactly.
So, and it's one, again, where because of the world that we live in and the connections in the world that we live in, that something that happens like an emerging disease event halfway across the world is potentially a threat to us where it might not have been previously. So I think, you know, the biggest things that, what we need and what we are working towards, as well as others, is trying to get an international, global understanding of the problems we face. And that's going to take at least communication around our shared goals, as well as an understanding of what, I think a real understanding of what our, what the threats are, particularly from emerging disease, and also the opportunities in some ways. But that understanding is really based on an understanding internationally that we live in a connected ecosystem, and that humans and animals and the environment that we live in are connected in ways that impact events like COVID-19 emerging in our populations. And so we're going to have to work together and cooperatively if we're going to, let alone understand, but mitigate some of these events. But I have hopes that we can, in part because we work with a lot of people on an international context.
Yes, I see. Before I let you go, I'd like to just point out to viewers that it's on the event page for this today, your article in The Conversation. And I'm hoping that you write, it's also been carried over to Scientific American, that I'm hoping that you will write a lot more and talk a lot more, because I do think the public will be receptive, but the public needs to know, and we haven't known up until now, and our attention hasn't been focused on the potential dangers until now, probably. But that you had an article in The Conversation, and the title and everything is on our event page, so I hope people will check that out. It's online, and I please keep writing and talking. It has been delightful to talk to you, and thank you so much. Before I let you, do you have anything else you'd like to add? Are you okay?
I think that's fine. Thanks, Yvonne. Gosh. Thanks for your encouragement, and we'll yes. keep doing the best we can.
I appreciate it very much. I'll be back in touch too. Thank you ever so much.
You're welcome.